Mine is a story of self-reliance, independence, and strong will. But the story continues with a life-changing decision as a result of giving God fully control of my life and fully trusting Him. My childhood was one of happiness and joy as I grew up on a farm within a family of believers and learned of Christ and His love for me. I also had a healthy fear of Satan. Every night I had night terrors as a child. While I envisioned Satan under my bed, I did not go to sleep in my bed, but I fell asleep with my parents as they watched TV and then went to bed. And when I did, I positioned myself in the center of the bed because I just had visions of him underneath my bed and wanted to protect myself from him. I also had various Christian songs that I would sing to get myself to sleep and to keep Christ in my mind as I went to sleep as a defense against Satan. With this, I asked my grandmother, who is a strong believer, to pray with me, and I knelt with her and asked Jesus into my heart. I wanted to make sure that I had all my bases covered and wouldn't be going to hell, and so I asked Jesus into my heart a few more times when I attended the Good News Club on Thursday nights as a young child, and then answered some altar calls at church as well when I would attend church, and we attended sporadically when I was growing up. And so I felt like I had it all covered and that I was good to go. And when I was in junior high, I even requested to be baptized, as I knew that that was something that a believer should do. So I did that as well. And then just kind of continued on. However, during that time, I didn't acknowledge my sin. I didn't acknowledge how Jesus' blood had washed me clean. And I just asked him into my heart as a means to avoid Satan because of my fear of Satan was so great at that time. As a teenager, I continued reading my Bible and praying, and I didn't participate in all the things that my friends were participating in. I didn't smoke, didn't drink, didn't party. Making that decision as a teenager is hard because you're one of the few that don't. And so that's a difficult decision. I've never been a follower, though. I've always been a leader and always followed what I felt was right. And I knew in my heart that those things were not right to do and did not participate in those things. However, I felt that I knew what God wanted. I knew that I wanted a Christian husband. I knew that I wanted to be married and become a teacher. And those were the goals I had in my life. So I felt I was a little more mature than everyone else my age, and started praying when I was 15 that I would meet someone that would be a Christian that I could date, because in my small school, there weren't very many people that showed that. Shortly after that, I met my husband, and I was 15 years old. Our first date was going to church, and we did that, and dated for 3 years after that. And so I was engaged at the age of 17 years old, and shortly after that I turned 18, became pregnant, got married 3 years from the day we had met, which happened to be a month out of high school. So at that time, we had three children, and I became a mother, as I had hoped, and became a teacher, got my first master's degree. But eventually we divorced, and that put me in a different situation. It caused me to have to rely on God wholly, day by day, month by month, hour by hour, to provide for my needs, because finances were particularly tight during that time. And so I started writing my prayers down, and when God answered them, and I began to discover that He was taking care of my needs. I could trust Him, and I could trust Him completely to take care of the things that I needed to be, the bills that needed to be taken care of, were taken care of on time. I started writing down the prayers, and I started writing down the dates they were answered, and they were answered each and every time. And this is the first time in my life I'd ever had to fully rely on Him. So I was learning that I could, and that I couldn't do it alone. As much as I was independent, I could not do that alone. I needed Him. I met my husband, John, in 2002. At that time, pursued my second master's degree in education and became an elementary principal. While I was a principal, I continued to enjoy learning, but my primary focus was studying educational theory and practice, and that's how I spent my days and my nights, focusing on education and how to make a reality the things I was studying about in the classroom and in the school. But I also knew at the same time that I was missing what God intended in my life, and many times I sat at my desk and I knew something major was missing. And it actually haunted me as I was at work, because I knew deep inside I wasn't pursuing what God had intended for me in my life. John and I moved to Ankeny in 2014 and began searching for a church. We attended a few, and we just hadn't found one that had really we felt was teaching us the truth we needed to hear. And we hadn't been really faithful church attenders up to that point, just periodically. We had several people that encouraged us to attend Saylorville, and so we began attending Saylorville, and after the first time we attended, we heard truth being spoken at the services, and I knew based on my studies in the Bible that what I was hearing meshed with what the Bible said, and that was important to me. So we attended faithfully. We also became members, and we attended a cell group for the very first time. And we were placed in Pastor Pat's group, and no skipping out there. Lots of accountability when you're in the pastor's group. So John and I continued to attend. And then in the fall of 2015, about a year later, I was listening to a podcast of David Platt, and he's an author and pastor that I enjoy listening to, and he also speaks truth based on scripture. And he, in this podcast, he said that asking Jesus into your heart was not biblically based. This is the first time I had heard that, and it didn't quite jive with what I thought I knew. And so I just kind of, it really challenged what I thought was to be true, and so I dismissed what he said, and I just continued on with my truth as I knew it. And then last fall, we had cell group at our house in October, and I invited a coworker who had said she was Christian to attend, and at that group, Pastor Pat began talking about salvation again, asking her about her relationship with Christ and you know, if she was saved, and if so, how she knew. And it began a long, challenging conversation, and Pastor even asked me to articulate what I knew in that area, and I felt like I was able to do that, but I still, there was an uneasiness that was beginning to grow in my heart, because I felt like something was missing there. I could articulate it, and yet I had not done it. So that followed again in January. I was listening to a sermon, and Pastor Pat touched on the fact that there could be members of the church that are attending or maybe have attended for years that might not be saved. And then my heart really quivered, because I really began to wonder, is that me? Is he talking about me? Here I am every Sunday, sitting in my special spot in the church, and I'm thinking I'm a Christian and I'm saved because I've asked Jesus into my heart and I'm a member of the church and I go to a cell group, but am I saved? So it just continued to add to my uneasiness that I had, and then it all kind of culminated on February 2nd, 2017. We went to cell group. Pastor Pat brought up salvation again, and this time I had enough. I'd heard it several times, and I was beginning. I realized at that moment that I wasn't saved, and the invitation was given, but I had to reconcile what I knew to be true and had wholly believed all my life with the reality that I was not really saved. And I was just shy of my 50th birthday, and I thought, how can I be this far along in my life, think I was saved, but not be saved? And I couldn't, that was really hard to swallow. And at that moment, there was a battle taking place in my heart and my soul, for my soul. And everybody there was so supportive and encouraging me. And yet I couldn't get over that hump. There's something that would just held me back. There was a battle just raging in my heart, and I couldn't quite do it. So I left the room for a moment, went to the restroom, kind of gathered my thoughts, and then I returned, and I was determined to humble myself and set aside my willfulness. And I kneeled, and I confessed my sin. I accepted Christ's gift of forgiveness, love, and eternal salvation. And it was a life-changing moment for me. I can't remember much else that was said that night. My brain, everything just completely changed in my thinking. And I have a quote from Charles Stanley I'd like to read. The Father blesses obedience, Jeremiah 7:23, and godly discipline, 1 Timothy 4:7 through 8, not human wisdom, Proverbs 14:12, and self-reliance, James 4:13 through 15. And the other verse I'd like to quote is Exodus 15:2. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation.
Amen, Rhoda. Amen. And the scripture that comes to my mind is 2 Corinthians 13 that says, examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Test yourselves. Don't you know that Christ lives in you unless you failed the test? And it was through this that you recognize it wasn't about you or the prayers you'd prayed or the things you'd done, but it was Christ alone. It was a joy in that cell group that night to see you humble yourself and place your faith truly in Jesus to be your Savior. Let's hear from your husband, because something special happened to him that night too, didn't it? Mm-hmm. So come on down, John. This is John Harris.
Good morning. My story began when I was young and grew up in a household with my mother of a strong faith, which kind of laid the foundation to where I am today. Went to United Methodist Church, and then mom took us to Assembly of God, and there I asked Christ into my heart, but it was kind of, I was young and went through that and got baptized and then jumped into my teenager years, which everything started going downhill from there. I got in with the wrong crowd and started doing a lot of drugs and just fell into a out of control spiral to where it brings me to 1993, to where it was a lot of partying and depression and a couple failed suicide attempts when I was at that age. And I kept partying, got highly involved with meth, and then in 95 I was just was at a party and left, took myself to the hospital. I don't even know how I got there, but when I got there I was almost to the point of death. My body was starting to shut down, and the doctor that went to the same church as my mom called her up at 6 a.m. and told my parents to come in and greeted them in the hallway and said, please pray like you've never prayed before, because this isn't good. But as I was laying there, I mean, it was so dark. My mom prayed for me, and I came out of it, and I stopped doing that at that time. But to look into something that was so dark, it stuck with me. And then as time went on, I got out of that and started cleaning up and sobering up. And then in 98, I got married, and marriage failed, but there's just kind of went down the wrong path. But then as time went on, as in my divorce, I was just hoping that I would find a good woman someday and have a good life, because I knew through the whole time that I was partying that it wasn't right. Deep in my heart, it wasn't right that I was not living correctly. But in 2002, Rhoda and I met and got married and had three wonderful children I got married in to help raise through their time. And we went to church once in a while and stuff, but nothing that really that stuck with us. And until we moved here to Ankeny and started attending Saylorville, and just what a warm welcome that we got here, and just you could feel the love in this place for everybody. And so we became, you know, started going to the cell group, Pastor Pat's, and then as time went on, you know, just thought I was saved, you know, I was good from, you know, when I was younger. But then that night when we were at his house at that cell group meeting and seeing what my wife was going through and her, you know, wondering, made me start wondering, am I truly a Christian? And it was just, it was so fascinating to see her humble herself and ask Christ in her life and forgive her, you know, for her sins and kneel in front of the cross. And so we're driving home and I'm sitting there thinking, I'm like, am I truly saved? So when we got home, I told her, I said, I don't know for sure. So we knelt down at the bed and I asked Christ to save me and, to forgive me for my sins. And it was just unbelievable, the weight that came off of my heart and has changed my life ever since. And I thank God every day that he has helped me. You know, he's always been there to help me and bring me through just the challenges and partying and all that, and to be able to walk away from every bit of that. I'm thankful to God every day. And the verse that means a lot to me is Psalms 145, verse 14. The Lord upholdeth all that fall and raiseth up all those that be bowed down.
Amen, John. And that night, that cell group night was an epic night for us to witness the Spirit of God working on Rhoda. But we all wondered, what about John? Because you were so quiet that night. We wondered, what's going on? We could see that you're almost like the deer in the headlights. But in reality, God was working in your heart. And it was exciting to see him humble you that very evening as well. We praise the Lord for your stories. Let's pray for John and Rhoda, shall we? Our Father, we thank you so much for not letting this couple off the hook, trusting their education, trusting the fact that they didn't do some of the things the people around them are doing. These things can be very deceiving to us, Lord, but they don't make us Christians, not until we humble our hearts before the cross, as John said, as Rhoda did, really in front of a number of people, very humbly on her knees, and then later that night, John. But you saw it all from heaven, Lord, and you now live in their hearts. Bless them for their stories. Bless them for their lives. And may they be greatly used of you and for your glory. And bless them for this act of obedience, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, John, we thank the Lord for your story. We'll do you first. And upon your profession of faith and obedience to God's word, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord, man. Praise the Lord. Rhoda, you too. We thank the Lord for your testimony, and upon your profession of faith, it's my joy to baptize you as well in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord, dear.